Who are you?
Me? I know who I am. I'm a dude playing a dude disguised as another dude.
What?
You a dude that don't know what dude he is?
Or are you a dude who has no idea what dude he is and claims to know what dude he is?
What the fuck are you guys talking about?
I'm playing other dudes.
I know what dude I am.
I'm the dude who's podcasting about the dude who's playing the dude disguised as another dude.
This is Patreon Requested Spoilers. This is
Spoilers. Woohoo! Pap, ready for a Teen Choice Award.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to a Patreon Requested Spoilers. This is Sebastian's pick. Loyal listener Sebastian. He had a question for us. We'll go Isis to Weestus. He said, I discovered the podcast when I was looking for a Lord of the Rings podcast. My question is, would you ever do the Hobbit series at one point like you did with the Lord of the Rings? I think he means a deep dive. And since that's just a yes or no, I also added, if we had to deep dive a franchise, what would you choose to deep dive? Brett, I think you're Eastus.
Yeah. I'll ask Sebastian a question. Do you hate us? Huh. Do you not remember the great timestamp debacle of 2019?
Barely survived.
These people almost killed each other because of that. And that would be really tough to do it again, because I did it last time at work, but I can't do that anymore. So here's the thing. I would do The Hobbit because I'm guessing I'm in the crazy minority here. I actually like those movies. I think they're like 1/100th of the Lord of the Rings other ones, but I do enjoy them enough. They get a little more ridiculous as they go, but it's still cool to me. It's weird how much visual effects these, but yes, I would do it. But I think after 21 episodes, I'd be really worn down by, I don't know, Stevie's negativity or somebody. I mean, it'd probably wear me down, and I'd probably have a hard time arguing against a lot of it, but I would do it if I think it'd be a huge hit. I think people would love it. So I guess.
Do you have an alternate? So you would want to do The Hobbit then? That would be your.
Yeah, that's fine. I haven't thought of anything else I'd want to do. I mean, like, I guess we could do Pirates, but not like 7 episodes a movie, but I think we could have fun with those maybe. But. Mm. Brett from Fort Wayne.
Well, I'll go next. I think I'm the next thesis. This is Pappy, Kalamazoo, Michigan. Your first question, Sebastian, there's no fucking way. There's just like a 0% chance we're ever going to do that. I think we should do the movies, but I don't know if, like, what's the third one? The Battle of Five Armies or whatever? That doesn't deserve.
That'd be exhausting.
7 episodes dedicated to it.
It needs medicine.
It doesn't even deserve one.
Josh is right. It needs medicine.
I don't even know if I've seen that one.
We have to be Lord of the Rings. Lord of the Rings completionists, right? Like, we've done the Ralph Bakshi one. We've done the god-awful animated Return of the King one, where there's a whip, there's a way.
We need to do The Hobbit and The Hobbit.
Got to do the new series, too.
Yeah, someday. We'll get to that, Sebastian. But if we had to deep dive something, it's not a series, but I think it would be pretty fun to do like a 7-part episode on Titanic, like James Cameron. I don't know if you guys would like it or not, but I think that would just be a good time. Fabricio? It's a long movie.
I would love that.
7 episodes?
I'm in, bro.
7 episodes? Maybe. And we could do 3 episodes, like 1 per hour.
I think it deserves 6 or 7.
I could go 6 on that.
There's a boatload of information in each.
Oh,
I see what he did.
Hey now.
See, look, we're already doing it. Look
see?
At this.
See?
The magic's happening.
Yeah. I think that would be fun. And it's topical. Topical, too. Grab some headlines. Who's next, thesis?
A lot of myths to dispel on that one.
Yeah. Josh, I think?
Hello, Josh from Goshen here. The ironic thing about this question is that I propose that we deep dive Tropic Thunder, and Stevie resoundingly said no to that idea.
What does that mean?
When?
Like, I said at the end of an episode, hey, maybe we should split Tropic Thunder up into 2 episodes, because Stevie was
absolutely
like...
Absolutely not.
Stevie, yeah, this is exactly what
absolutely
happened.
Absolutely fucking not.
Stevie chose it.
For what reasoning?
What's that?
For what reasoning to do it in two episodes?
I'll give you the reasoning. Stevie chose the movie when he won the movie game.
And then, I know, it was so funny.
And then Sebastian had already chosen it. So I was like, if we got this much demand, split it into two.
I forgot.
Also, spoilers lore, I thought we kind of decided that we might cover The Godfather over this Christmas break in this way.
We did talk about that.
Oh, yeah.
And that was last Christmas break.
Yeah, that was the last time anybody talked about
Needless to say, the Fast Furious Jurassic Park crossover series that you guys never got down to do. But anyway, Josh from
Goshen.
Don't
blame us for that.
Blame ChatGPT on that one.
Yeah, no shit.
Stevie?
Yeah. Would I ever pod the Hobbit? I mean, if we had to, like Pap said, if we were completionists, I'd be compelled to do it begrudgingly. And I would probably just, Brett, you're probably right. I'd probably weigh you down at a certain point. After the first, I don't know, that third movie is really rough. First one's okay. I enjoyed Smaug. Battle of the Five Armies is just atrocious. But yeah, Josh took my answer. I was going to say Godfather's part one and two, and three doesn't exist.
We would have to do three.
No, we wouldn't. No. Fine, we do three first then. I'm not going to end on that downer of a note.
If I took your answer, I apologize, Stevie, but I do have a follow-up question for you. If we cut it up into like a bunch of like 45-minute segments or whatever, if you could choose any segment or like little act like that out of Godfather 1 or 2, what would you choose?
Oh, dude.
I know what it comes down for me.
It's all so beautiful. I would have to say the Havana deal in Cuba. That to me is loaded with like super history. And it's really, really compact full of information if you break it down. Yeah, I would say the Havana deal.
I had a feeling you'd pick Godfather 2. I would either take the first 45 minutes of the first one or the second 45 minutes. First one, you got the wedding and then up to the Salazzo deal. Second one, you got the assassination attempt and then like all the stuff with McCluskey. And God, it would be so freaking good.
Also,
it's so good.
In Godfather Part 2, I also wouldn't mind doing Anthony's... like communion party. I think when Fredo's wife is dancing with another man provocatively in front of the family and Rocco goes over to Fredo and goes, Michael says, you have to do something about this or I have to. And Fredo's like, yeah, go ahead. It's such a telling.
Yeah.
Like it's just so on the nose for Fredo. I love that sequence.
Do you think you talk about, do you think he's like the most underrated character like ever?
Fredo?
No, Nero. Neri, never mind.
Oh, Al Neri. I love Al Neri. I still think Rocco is the one that led everybody on the compound to assassinate Michael.
He's definitely stinky.
Yeah, but yeah, I love Al Neri. Anything in that universe. But yeah, Josh, didn't get out of this question. Anything of The Godfather parts one and two, I would deep dive in a heartbeat, just not three.
While we're talking about things that'll never happen, like a Godfather deep dive or the Furious Jurassic Park crossover.
What the hell?
I did side text Josh, and one of my dreams for this podcast, and like I said, it will never happen, but like a Patreon exclusive episode of the Patreon or the Spoilers Boys doing an audiobook of The Hobbit, where we each play different characters, you know? And really, that dream was just inspired by Brett playing Smeagol. I think that would be amazing if you just read the lines of that character. But, Mikey, what do you think?
We can't leave it at that. Like, who's who in this? Like, if we're doing, like, audiobook, Lord of the Rings, the Council of Elrond, or, like,
Josh
a scene.
Josh is Sam.
I think Corey would be Gandalf.
Corey as Gandalf? Yeah. Are you insane? He's a hobbit for sure.
He's going to be like... Okay.
But Josh has basketball shoes.
Corey. Corey, how would Gandalf say that?
He's ready for the squeaks.
Do your line in Good Time. How would Gandalf do that? We took two. We were so... One of my all-time favorite spoilers.
Next thing I know, this fucking ring shows up. I don't know what the fuck is going on. Because we were so fucking fucked up.
He definitely was smoking that weed, too. That's good. I forgot that.
Speaking of Hobbit weed, Mikey, back to you.
Yeah, sorry, Sebastian.
Hobbit, or what would you want to deep dive?
Pap, I think I agree with you. I don't think we could deep dive on The Hobbit. I watched the first two. I don't remember liking them that much, but I feel like everybody would be feel like a bit of a drag going through that for so long. Because we really went in deep on Lord of the Rings, so we'd have to do it up the same way. Otherwise, it would just... yeah. And to do a different series, I don't even know. It'd have to be something equally as long for each movie. Otherwise, can't cut up a 90-minute movie between five, six people. That'd be
seven
insane.
Episodes on Ghost Dad, starring Bill Cosby.
Yeah, I think we should just do them regular style. How we do most episodes, the movie game, but to do a deep dive on the Hobbit trilogy, that would be rough.
Cornetto trilogy.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe the Matrix. That'd be fun.
Oof, but kill me there too.
But the last one would be unwatchable. I don't know if you guys have seen that, but it's bad. But yeah, I can't think of anything. It has to be a really long movie and it has to be like three really long movies. I don't know too many of those.
We did the first Matrix a very long time ago, and we never did any of the sequels. Nobody touched them. Yeah. I think Josh, you picked that.
I'd actually like to see Daniel Craig Bond movies.
Can I just put a note in Pappy saying that we aren't going to do all these other projects offhand? There's a specific reason why we can't recreate a whole fucking book, audiobook, and then put it up in our feed. Like, it's complete copyright. Like, we already toe the line enough with all the clips we play and the music. There's no way we can read the whole Hobbit and put it up. Like,
what if we changed it up?
What if we put it at 1.10 speed?
What if we had no periods or paragraph breaks?
Change all the names.
What if we rap and sing an entire Post Malone album?
There we go.
How much money would we lose?
Our channel would be claimed. It'd be over. Post Malone's come for us before. He'll come again.
These are our last messages echoing out through the universe right now as Post Malone plays in the background to take us out.
There you go. The episode's gone now. Just from
Post Malone, are you here?
Corey.
It's a good song, though.
So you said this was a very easy question for you. I'm curious.
Hello, this is Corey, Kylo Ren Memes. I'm recording out of Simi Valley, California. This one is easy for me, Pappy. Right, so in terms of doing The Hobbit, I'd lean in the direction of no, but if you guys wanted to, I'd do it. Like, you know, it's whatever. Even if we're doing podcasts on stuff I don't like, it's fine. I like to kind of exaggerate that a little bit and say, like, no, fuck that. But, you know, come on, I've reviewed fucking the 93 Super Mario Brothers and, like fucking Theodore Rex. Like
Escape from L.A.
Battlefield Earth, it's Pat. Like, yeah, I've done some bad fucking movies. Like, what do I care, right?
Three Ninjas.
Los Enchiladas.
Exactly, Brett.
The third, exactly. Fourth one.
So that is my answer, actually. I want to deep dive on Three Ninjas because some of you guys know this, but I have like a very deep and inescapable attachment to Three Ninjas.
Yeah.
Like Three Ninjas continually comes up on Big Dumb Movie. We've done so many Three Ninjas episodes. In fact, we're going to do the first Three Ninjas movie again at Big Dumb Movie.
Like anniversary, or
we're doing it again,
remastered.
It's the Blu-ray.
You know, Three Ninjas has got to be my answer, but I know you guys wouldn't actually go for that. So I have a proposal that you guys might actually go for, and that's Rings of Power. I like the Rings of Power show. Some of it sucks, but I still like it.
Big fan.
So I don't know how you guys feel about it.
I like it.
But there's some cool stuff. I liked it.
Yeah.
Too bad they're going to scrap it, I think, right?
Well, it's not going to come out for 9 years now because the writers and actors strike.
I mean, they botched a couple things, in my opinion, but It's still, we both really loved it, actually. We both liked it a lot.
There's a moment when Galadriel's like riding a horse and like smiling, and it's like slow-mo, and it's placed in a very weird like moment because she's all like, she's like upset and distraught, and then like she gets on this horse and she's like super happy. And I remember watching that exact moment being like, okay, that is really fucking bad. Like, even I got to admit, like, that's really fucking bad. But other than small stuff like that, it's a pretty fucking cool show.
I think the worst thing that happened for Rings of Power was House of the Dragon coming out at the same time. I feel like that kind of stole some of its fantasy wind.
I'm watching House of Dragon now. It's pretty good.
It's good.
Yeah.
High praise from Mikey. Very critical.
Yeah.
Pretty good.
Of Game
well,
of
I rewatched... not most of Game of Thrones, but like some of it, and kind of the last season going into House of the Dragon. And
how did you pick which parts to rewatch though?
Just like Battle of the Bastards, and then just like most of the last season. But I mean, it wasn't as bad as I remembered it, but I feel like they must have redone some CGI or something, because I don't remember it looking nearly as good. But I don't know. It was still good. I just was baffled by people's motivations again at the end. That just was the weak point. But House of the Dragon seems fine.
And when you say you're watching House of Dragon now, I do assume you mean like as we're potting currently.
Honestly. No, I'm watching Tropic Thunder again now.
Same. I got it in a little screen.
I was watching it during the tornado warning yesterday, so it's a bit of a hazy watch.
Yeah, man. Scary. I saw something say, is Illinois the new tornado alley? I was like, dear God.
Yeah. So
scary.
Rewatching some of it now.
Speaking of the movie Mikey's watching now, Tropic Thunder, we should probably get into
Woo!
It. Stevie, I want to start with you, because you had picked this movie, and I think once you saw Sebastian had requested it, you changed to Wally.
I didn't see it. I got yelled at for picking it.
Yeah. Sorry about that.
It's a little bit different than just coming across it.
What you love movies about Hollywood. Can you tell us just like a quick setup premise? Because I think the commercials at the beginning do a good job of that, but like, What about Tropic Thunder was something that you wanted to pick initially? Because I feel like this is in your wheelhouse with like Bowfinger and other movies that you like.
In 2013, when the Earth's rotation came to a halt,
it has declared all of North America a disaster area.
My fellow Americans, to come together.
The world called on the one man who could make a difference. When it happened again, the world called on him once more, and no one saw it coming. Three more times. Now, the one man who made a difference five times before is about to make a difference again. Only this time, it's different.
Who left the fridge open?
Tug Speedman, Scorcher 6, Global Meltdown.
Here we go again. Again.
I do love how this movie just drops you in immediately before even, you know, the DreamWorks credits roll whatsoever. I do like that a lot. But you're right. I do like movies about Hollywood. I do like movies about movie making. But this movie takes kind of veers off from that. It's not really about, you know, making a movie as much as it is like lampooning, you know, the actors themselves. And This movie isn't really a spoof. There's a lot of layers to it. I do like this, like the satirical moments with it, but I just like the idea of putting you know, three head cases out in the jungle trying to survive, and they're all going through their own shit and just how nuts they are. That's one thing I enjoy about this movie quite a bit.
Is Nick Nolte all three of the nutcases that you're talking about, or is this different?
Gary Busey Jr.
He does look just like him.
It's just like him.
It's weird.
Wrote the book.
Utah. Wrote the book. Four-leaf K-back. I wrote the book.
Nice, Brett.
Yeah, I'm mad at you, Stevie. I bet you didn't name your son Four-leaf.
I didn't name him Four-leaf.
Before we get to Four-leaf, though, you mentioned those nutcases. Brett, did you have any... pick any of the characters. We got Robert Downey Jr. Huge stat cast, by the way, in this movie. Insane cast. Jack Black, Ben Stiller, any of those guys, the characters stand out to you, or anyone?
I laughed. I laughed at like almost at everything Robert Downey Jr. said in this movie. when he was the Chinese guy, I thought it was a freaking unbelievable like 5 minutes of cinema.
Shut your mouth, follow my lead. Twin genie, voila, Sasaya, why may you worry? Wait a minute, the Najini. That da we go wagushi. Sao da chili. Look in here, y'all.
But it's all awesome. I mean, like, it's just so, it's like the most satirical thing you can do, and it's done so unbelievably in this movie, I think. I mean, yeah, so he's literally the greatest actor of all time. 5 Oscars. I mean, he's as method as you can get. I mean,
he's
Daniel
Day-Lewis.
Surgery.
Basically, yeah. Right? Yeah.
Even crazier.
With layers of Russell Crowe.
Yeah, he said Daniel Day-Lewis, Russell Crowe, and somebody else he based it on. But yeah, he's an Australian guy playing... I don't remember. A black guy, but... And the dichotomy and the scenes with him and the other... I can't remember his name. What's the other black guy's name?
Al Pacino.
Oh, God, I'm gonna forget Al Pacino. I think they're so funny, and I think I like how he kind of wears him down. He doesn't get him to completely get off the method train at the end. That's more like Tug, but he kind of wears him down as he goes. He gets him to admit that he knows he has a problem, but it's kind of like all he knows, and he'll pretty much do anything as an Oscar. And then for an Oscar, and you brought this up to me before, Stevie, but I had never seen the full R-word scene.
Oh yeah.
It's such a, I mean again people can be offended by it if they want, but it's such a,
it's
Hollywood,
not offensive.
No, I don't think it. First of all, there were three things people complained about in this movie. We'll get Josh. Say your piece later.
Social justice warrior,
he's back.
Oh, but just to it's not offensive.
It's not offensive.
I was watching the clip from when Robert Downey Jr. was on Joe Rogan, just where they were talking about Tropic Thunder. And he's like, yeah, everyone was mad about that. And I totally just like was like, thank God no one said anything about the blackface.
That's insane. Good interviews about that, too. Like Jamie Foxx says is funny talking about that.
That's the best Stevie question I got. Actually, I have 2 Stevie questions, but this is maybe the best one. Why can Robert Downey Jr. do this? Like,
great question.
I think we all agree it's okay, but other people,
other people like who? Gen Zers? Fuck off.
Other people have tried to do satire with this, and it doesn't work. And you know it doesn't work. This does, and I'm asking why.
Well, not only does it work, it was
because his name's not Thomas C. Howell.
Yeah.
Soul Man.
It was rubber stamped by the Academy. He got a Best Supporting Actor nomination for this role. Like,
well deserved, in my opinion. That's too. Pretty awesome.
That's like, I think that's one of the kind of brilliant parts about Lincoln Osiris and Robert Downey Jr. is the simple fact. Lincoln Osiris.
They have the best names in this.
Dude, movie. They have the most glorious names. But I think it's kind of the genius of this movie, the simple fact that it's like, it's not like Robert Downey Jr. landed the role of Al Pacino. You know what I mean? His character is literally a method actor. And the idea that a method actor would go through pigmentation surgery to play an African-American soldier is the most, and not just on top of that, an Australian method actor is the funniest shit on earth. Like,
when he hops out of the OR, dude, and he's like, got his hands on the doctor's face, like, we fucking did it. We're going to be fucking legends.
He wheeled himself out. Dude, I was dying.
Everything he said is amazing.
Stevie, there's a little scene between him and Ben Stiller where Ben is like, if you don't think any of this is real, why are you still in character? Robert Downey yeah, Jr. Dude. Says something like, well, I know why I am, but I don't need to tell you. Like, what is he thinking at that point?
Dude, like some of the shit he says, like when Damon is like going over to like to grab cell phones from people, and he's like, there were no cell phones in 1969, I'm head to toe legit. Like that shit yeah. cracks me up. And just
my favorite little, line. Do you care if I say it or am I interrupting too much?
Go ahead.
Don't you get it? He's messing with our heads. That's what all that playing God stuff was about. He's trying to get us to act good, save the movie.
He ain't playing God. He's being judged by him.
After the director blows up, he goes, he ain't playing God. He's being judged by him. All mysterious.
Dude, I was just about to say that. He's being judged by him. Like,
oh my God. I'm reading some of his quotes right now. It's so funny. Stop tailgating me, you pasty teabag. I'm going potty. Want to hold my dick? So freaking funny.
Go ahead and cut it. We're flipping the script. You can't cry.
Corey, while we're on this topic, though, I no movie other than Tropic Thunder, like or Tropic Thunder is like the example of what I see people on the internet say, you couldn't make this movie today. You couldn't make this movie today. Do you? I know you hate that question. But what do you think about that? Because it's brought up so much about Tropic Thunder.
It is. And Blazing Saddles is the other thing yep. that people use. Mm-hmm. People love to use those. It can never be made today. I mean, I must be fucking old because I feel like Tropic Thunder was made today.
Dude.
Isn't this just made? You know, Pappy, Tropic Thunder would have to be adjusted ever so slightly. Right. And I don't think it's the blackface thing. I don't think it's the R word. I think it's the slight homophobia. It's only slight, and they'd only have to change things slightly. And I don't think, I'm not saying they would have to or I want them to necessarily. I guess I'm saying is that a studio probably would just because it's kind of a divisive, semi-divisive topic, right? Because they, you know, there is some like disgust with some of the characters that comes along with that. And I don't know if that necessarily is needed for those characters, right? I don't think that's like that's their thing. I can understand why they're using the R word when they're using it. I can understand why this dude is doing blackface.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of to me like the Always Sunny thing. Like, I think it is okay to do blackface sometimes. I'm going to come out and say that.
Remix.
I think it's okay to do blackface here. I think it's okay and it's Always Sunny. And the reason is because the people that are doing it are wrong for doing it.
Right. Yeah. You're laughing at them for doing that in the context of the movie or the show.
Right. Exactly. It's like, wow, what a bold move by this fucking crazy person to do that. Like, they think like that's okay. That's funny that they think it's cool to do that.
Definitely.
I think that the Always Sunny Lethal Weapon episodes have gotten pulled from Hulu, though.
Yes. Yeah.
No.
So freaking lame. And the Scrubs ones. I mean, like, I hate that so much.
They're hilarious in context.
It's the point. These are terrible people.
Mm-hmm.
I think they were only pulled in some countries, though, right? Not probably in our one. Country.
I tried to watch it, I think, like, a couple months ago, and it wasn't on there.
What about? Oh, all right,
come back to me in 30 seconds. I'm checking.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it's funny because like I see more people say you couldn't make Tropic Thunder today than I see people sincerely like complain about the blackface or the R word or anything else.
The reason I think they're able to skirt it, and the way I think they'd be able to explain it today, is like in my head is. Kirk Lazarus, who's playing Lincoln Osiris, isn't looking at it from the Kirk Lazarus point of view. He's looking at it from the point of view of Lincoln Osiris because yeah. he's still in character. as a black man in Vietnam in 1969.
Holy shit, you cracked the code.
You got it, Stevie.
It's staying. That's brilliant. By the way, confirmed pulled from It's Always Sunny. The gang makes Lethal Weapon 6. That breaks my heart.
Dude. Yeah.
There's multiple.
What about the Wiz episode?
The gang turns black?
Yeah.
I think that one's still there.
Then how can you... Oh. Yeah.
Just going to have to sail the high seas to watch that episode.
Have you actually heard the extra story about when they do that Lethal Weapon?
No.
I believe either Caitlin Olsen or somebody actually cut themselves really bad while filming that. And they had to take him to the hospital. And Rob McElhenney was in the hospital in complete blackface. And he didn't remember. And people are staring at him. either he or she told that story on like Conan or something like that. So that would be awesome. Like, because they rushed her because she was bleeding. It was like a really deep cut or something.
Here's the ultimate question, though. Would you guys personally ever do blackface?
No.
No. Ooh. I'm not rich and famous. I mean, no. I don't know.
What's the context?
Yeah, what's the context?
Yeah, I mean, come on.
I can't think of one where I would be in blackface.
Do we have a Tropic Thunder-esque movie?
Yeah, that's the only context.
But even if you read the script, it's a rough sell.
It scared the shit out of Robert Downey.
Especially since he hadn't come back yet. Like, he was only just kind of starting to come back.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. It's a huge risk.
Because, like, I think it was Tropic Thunder and Iron Man came out the same year.
Yeah, oh, wait, yeah.
Insane.
Oh, wow.
What a year.
That's crazy.
And, like, he just come off of doing, like, Kiss Kiss Bang Bang and Charlie Bartlett. And those were, I think Charlie Bartlett was, he was still uninsurable at that point. And I think that was one who was still uninsurable, and I think he was insured for Iron Man and Tropic Thunder. But...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, this is...
I mean, people saw this movie and were like, oh, shit, that's right. Robert Downey Jr. is really funny. I forgot about that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it's insane because he went on to make like a bill... Like, he personally went on to make like $1 billion in Disney movies as that Marvel character.
Josh, I think it's a little bit of a loaded question because what we might consider blackface, that like loser behind in Twitter, they think that like, let's say I go... This would be a bad idea, and I wouldn't do this personally for me, but like you go as like a coal miner for Halloween or something where I'm playing something that's not a person and I'm in all black or I'm dressed like a panda bear or something like that, and part of my face is, people call that blackface, like they're that stupid. So I would do that and I'd flip off anybody who thinks that's a problem, but like to go out dressed as a black person, no, I wouldn't do that.
Here's the thing. If you watch a movie...
My wife's shaking her head like crazy at me.
If you watch a movie from the 20s...
I don't know what I said that was so bad, but she's got a... I don't know. Go ahead, Pat. Sorry.
Well, Mikey, can you take us through some of the other characters? We got Jeff Portnoy, Jack Black, Tug Speedman, Ben Stiller.
Yeah, Ben Stiller, Tug Speedman. He's... Who is he? He's supposed to be kind of like Tom Cruise, Mission Impossible,
Stallone,
action star.
Stallone sounds more, yeah.
Kurt Russell, a little bit. I see a little Kurt Russell there.
But just totally oblivious, cannot emotionally act on screen. That's kind of the impetus for the whole movie is... Yeah, he's having a scene with Robert Downey Jr.'s character, and he can't cry on command. And this scene is—it's a one take because they got explosions going off in the background at the same time for some reason. I don't know, poor production planning. But Danny McBride's character sees the signal from the director, and they blow the shot. And Ben Stiller, Tug Speedman, can't emote on cue, so this movie is just like 5 weeks behind according to Access Hollywood or something. So on the first day, it's just a disaster because Tug Speedman has no emotions.
Yeah, presented by Maria Menounos.
I love her. Yeah,
I actually wrote her on Instagram once. Sometimes I DM celebrities and I'm like, do you want to do a podcast? So I invited her on. Maybe one day she'll write back and she'll be on one of these episodes.
Did she read it? Was it on Red? Scene?
It wasn't on Red, but she does podcasts. She has a podcast called Heel Squad.
Mm-hmm. She also does the gas station videos. I know you guys have been to a pump.
And the movies. She's always on the mm-hmm. when we go to Regal. Our theater.
Is she healthy again?
Regal, yeah.
She unhealthy?
She had cancer.
Oh. Didn't know.
Why don't you DM her, Corey, and ask?
Mikey, I am happy you brought up Danny McBride, though, because this is before I think Danny McBride really took off. And I had to pause it watching it again this time because I was nearly in tears laughing. There's like, this movie is full of little small lines that kill me. Like, you know, especially when Four Leaf says, like, I wrote the book, or, you know, what does he say about beds? Like, beds scare me.
Just little shit. Beds give me nightmares.
Oh, yeah, beds give me nightmares. Like, I love shit like that. But Danny McBride is a comedic genius because I'm positive he improvised this line when he's like all hyped up about to light those bombs off. And he's like, I need these two to speak American. I got these two making sweaters behind me. I'm trying to blow this juggle up. Like, it's such a good line.
Danny McBride's great. Also, Bill Hader's in this too. Yeah, like a little,
I forgot he was in it.
A little side role. Josh, can you just take us through? Oh, actually, Corey, let me toss this to you because I feel like Jack Black is doing a parody in his opening commercial too of a movie we did recently on Big Dumb Movie.
Oh yeah,
get some Nutty Professor vibes from him.
No, check out the recent Big Dumb Movie, Nutty Professor, where I reference that. Absolutely, man. So he's doing the Meet the Fatties, right? You can tell he's like the comedic, like he's like in this rut of just doing bullshit, right? Absolute bullshit that people love. It's kind of the same joke from like Funny People with Adam Sandler doing those stupid fucking baby movies.
Will there be you? Anything else?
Oh, yes, my dear man. More pain.
Granny, ew!
Out the wheel!
This summer, America's favorite obese family is back.
Ew, gross!
You're just mad because I'm skinny.
I'm not.
Jeff Portnoy. Jeff Portnoy. Jeff Portnoy. And Jeff Portnoy are The Fatties. Part 2.
In some countries, it's considered a compliment.
Letting loose this summer.
You can't touch this.
It looks like absolute, like, comedy bottom of the barrel trash. Like, lowest common denominator possible. And, you know, he doesn't really have much going on other than the fact that he is a drug addict in this movie. And one of the things I really don't like about this movie is I feel like Jack Black is just underutilized. Do you guys feel that at all?
Which
are you
weird,
like,
because he's second billed?
Yeah, but like his drug angle of, like, you know, just like needing his fix the whole time, it kind of wears out for me.
Yeah, all of his scenes are pretty much the same thing of him like sneaking off into the woods trying to get high. And then it getting kind of not going to plan. So seems like that's kind of the only thing going on in his.
I think there's a brilliant payoff, though.
Yeah.
When he's on the ground screaming my ass, like, that's a fantastic scene. Like, I don't care what anybody says. Like, that's brilliant comedy. And also, when they were filming this movie.
Wait. Why do you like that so much?
It's just so out of left field. And it's just kind of in the middle of chaos, seeing Jack Black screaming, my ass, my ass.
Plus his butt is kind of his moneymaker.
Yeah. And
it's a little bit of,
I mean, plus when they were filming this, he got bucked by that water buffalo and kicked about 15 feet away.
Oh my God.
And they didn't even catch it on camera. That's like the sad part. Man could have died. Didn't catch it on camera.
I like a minute, but it's almost like, well, there was 20 minutes in the movie where I had forgotten that Ben Stiller was even in the movie because I was so into what was going on with, like, Robert Downey Jr. Plus, every time Tom Cruz just get eyes on the screen. I'm sure we'll get to him. So I love Jack Black so much that maybe they could have been utilized more, but
it's really hard to get past the performance of RDJ. He's every line is so hilarious.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. A well-deserved Oscar nom. But sorry, Josh, I think Brett mentioned Tom Cruise. He's just another one who I want to touch on. Apparently playing Harvey Weinstein.
No.
Who is it?
Scott Rudin.
He's got a guy, yeah. He's got a beef with somebody. You know about it, I'm sure.
Scott Rudin is famous for like throwing his cell phones at assistants, kicking his assistants out of moving cars, punching a hole in every wall he can find.
He does kind of look like Scott Rudin. I just Googled him.
He looks... the podcast I listened to with John August and Craig Mazin, I think John had worked for Scott Rudin in the past as an assistant. And on the pod, he told some horror stories about Scott.
See, it says his physical appearance was more than likely based on this movie's producer, Stuart Kornfeld. But I think a lot of it said maybe it was based on a guy named Sumner Redstone who completely torpedoed him at Paramount Pictures. And he's got like a beef with him. But maybe, I don't know who you're talking about. So you said Scott Rudin?
Mm-hmm.
Let me look him up.
Sumner Redstone looks like a fucking ghoul. This guy is horrifying. He looks like a mannequin come to life that's melting.
Oh my God, yeah. Ooh.
Tom Cruise, though, his performance as this conglomerate of asshole agents or whatever.
Yeah.
I think he's just... the end scene aside, where he's dancing, which I really dislike, I think...
I don't like the dancing.
He's used so sparingly and well, and it really feels like Tom Cruise really gets this humor. I don't know how to explain it. He seems, despite his Scientology and all his weirdness, he seems to like really get this role, and it's just good to see because it is so funny whenever he's on screen yelling at someone. I love it every single time.
Oh my God, dude. Something just clicked for me. It's because he's channeling David Miscavige.
No!
The chairman of the Board of Scientology.
Well, that's it, boys. Lock up shop. Shit. They're coming for us.
Yeah. If Post Malone didn't get us, Scientology's definitely got to get us now.
That was fun while it lasted.
Pretty sure we said his name quite a few times on the Battlefield Earth pod.
Has Shelley been found yet?
I don't think so.
Damn.
Oh, man.
He hasn't been found.
Breaking news. Still
David Miscavige is known for treating people in this way. So I think that's probably a little bit of it, although they would never admit that, you know, Cruz.
I don't know what you're talking about. I've only heard good things about him. Let's move on.
I don't know. I'm with you, though, Josh. Like, when Tom Cruise is screaming, that shit's hilarious to me. Like, when he's telling the, what's the clan called, or the heroin producers, like, fire something?
The Red Dragon or
Red
something?
Dragon.
The
Red
Dragon.
Fire dragons or something like that. He's gonna like, it's red.
He's gonna like firebomb their ass and literally go face fuck yourself. Like, that's hilarious. I don't know.
It's not just,
yeah, really, because he's the way he's saying it sounds real and it's scary. Mm-hmm. The way he yells, like, it would be terrifying to get yelled at by Tom Cruise.
Flaming dragon.
To use a basketball analogy, Pappy, I feel like I'd like to point out Tom Cruise's like offside defense. When he's not yelling and he's in the room, his presence is felt, and you can tell he's teeing up, and you just like are waiting, despite whatever great actor is like delivering the lines, you're just waiting for him to like fucking go off again. And I love it.
This is the last horseman. Who is this?
This is Flaming Dragon.
Okay. Flaming Dragon. Fuck face. First, take a big step back and literally fuck your own face. Now, I don't know what kind of pan-Pacific bullshit power play you're trying to pull here, but Asia Jack is my territory. So whatever you're thinking, you better think again. Otherwise, I'm going to have to head down there, and I will rain down on a godly fucking firestorm upon you. You're going to have to call the fucking United Nations and get a fucking binding resolution to keep me from fucking destroying you. I am talking scorched earth, motherfucker. I will massacre you. I will fuck you up.
There is something about his physical appearance, though. He's so hairy, and like his watch is like barely around his
big, his big fake hands, yeah, are really funny too, though.
Yeah.
I, the director decides like where the camera's going to be, right? I know it's a dumb question, but I don't know any technical stuff.
Ben Stiller killed this as director.
I was going to say, the camera work in the scene with I Wrote the Book, where it's filmed like Tom Cruise is over people's shoulder, is so freaking awesome. Like, go back and watch it again. He's always framed. Like, he's even leaning around somebody at one point. Like, he doesn't need to lean around anybody because he's looking at the whole thing. But it's so cool where the cameras are at when they're catching him in the background.
I got to say, a director, especially a director who's acting in the movie, I think they're going to be trusting their lead cinematographer to do this.
Yeah, sure.
And they're going to be looking at dailies and telling them what to improve and maybe how to tweak things. But cinematography by John Toll.
John Toll, who is like a huge cinematographer. He was the cinematographer on Braveheart and another Tom Cruise movie, which despite its flaws is a really beautiful looking movie, which is The Last Samurai.
Oh, I love Last Samurai.
I do too, actually.
Just think about that, Braveheart and fucking Tropic Thunder.
Well, it's got like a good below the line production team. Like, what's his name? The makeup guy, Rick Baker, did all of the makeup. He's pretty famous for doing that.
Yeah. Of Nutty Professor fame.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
That's awesome.
When I was looking at the writing credits came up, I was like, I knew Justin Theroux wrote it, but when I read it, I thought it said Etan Cohen. At first, I'm like, no shit, Etan Cohen?
Guy,
yeah, a different guy. There's also the agent, Matthew McConaughey. Like, again, just a stacked up to down cast.
Insane.
Stevie, what about Matthew McConaughey? Do you like his performance in this?
I do, because that was written and accepted by Owen Wilson.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, at that time is when he tried to end his life. So I thought Matthew McConaughey did that role really well. And this is like before the McConaissance, too. This Definitely. Is when like Matthew McConaughey was still like rom-com guy. And so I thought he plays this role super well. And it's written in a way where it's like, yeah, I could totally see Owen Wilson in this role. But I think Matthew McConaughey makes it enough of his own where it's like, he's funny enough.
Mm-hmm. Obsessed with TiVo.
I love that look he gives that picture of him and his son in just disgust. Just that glance.
At least you get to choose your son. Rick Peck. Again, great character names.
Listen, Becker. Fuckstick.
Josh, we haven't really talked about the story at all, just at a high level. But was there anything from when they're in the jungle or landing in the jungle that you found particularly funny, or maybe just talk us through a little bit of what actually happens in the story, how they get in this predicament?
It's pretty convoluted at the beginning, but basically their director, he's like a rookie director. He's played by Steve Coogan, and he's really trying to like make the set his own. He's got this big budget film, but he gets undressed by Tom Cruise because he's not keeping control of the actors. And he gets this crazy idea planted in his brain by Nick Nolte to, if you want to get a real movie, take these guys out into the shit. So this director is like on his last hair of sanity. You kind of get the feeling. And so he agrees to this and they take him out. And Steve Coogan, like I said, he's like lost his mind a little bit. And he's just like, he's like Bobby Knighting the group. Like, he's slapping people around. He's yelling at them. He's like,
they seem into it. It's
them.
Working. His speech is working for them.
Yeah, they cheer. Yeah, yes. Bobby Knight, like, he got results, did he not? Especially when he wasn't supervised. Like, you could just imagine Bobby Knight in the middle of the jungle beating the shit out of some of his players. But Mikey.
Yep.
But anyway, I think the inciting incident here, and something we need to linger at a little bit for discussion, is after Steve Coogan gives this rousing locker room talk, he fucking explodes for real. The whole thing is supposed to be like this movie set, but a man dies violently.
And I will be shooting as well, from unseen vantage points, so that every glorious moment is captured on film. And believe me, gentlemen, it will be glorious. If it looks real, chances are it probably is. You wanted to be actors? You wanted to occupy the skin of another human being? Well, get ready to occupy the skin of a terrified US infantry grunt surrounded by death, crawling up Satan's bottom. There'll be ambushes, enemy fire, your own little personal slice of Nam. This radio goes to the chopper and the chopper only. The chopper is God, and I am Jesus Christ, his son. You are my chosen disciples. And no one gets to go home till we get the shots. Put on your war faces, gentlemen. Now, let's go and make the greatest war movie ever!
Yeah!
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 All
right. Woo. Yeah. Oh.
Yeah!
This might be my favorite scene with Ben Stiller lifting the head and being like, I forgot about it.
It just tastes like corn syrup. Blood flavored corn syrup.
Warm. There's like a really brilliant callback to that too. Like later in the movie, it still doesn't click with Ben Stiller with how stupid he is. He's getting lifted out of the water and like dunked over and over again. He's like, Damien, cut, cut.
That's the part that I said that I'd never seen this movie, but that part makes me laugh every time I think about it.
That's so fucking stupid. Cut, Damien, cut.
Damn it, Cockburn.
I think, Stevie, you were talking about movies, about making movies. This is really where the rubber really hits the road for that, because I think the movie does something special here with the head scene, where because it's a movie within a movie and the person doesn't know that it's a movie anymore, it kind of makes your suspension of belief heighten. And it's really, really gross when he's doing that thing with the head. It's funny, but it's disgusting too.
Starch and corn syrup, boys.
And I know we already talked about it, but the fact that like Robert Downey Jr. in character is like the only one who's like speaking truth to like what's actually happening, but he can't let go of the character the whole time.
He still can't let go of the character.
Did you guys, I don't know, I think that the first part of this movie is freaking hilarious. The second part's really good and also funny, but not as good as the first part. The heroin production camp, the group gets split up and they end up there. Corey, I felt like you're going to be on my page. Did you like the little kid heroin production king guy or whatever happens there?
I didn't particularly care for like him as the leader, you know, except for one moment, right? There's a moment where him and Jack Black are having like a physical like fist fight. And this is like way later in the movie. I'll just talk about it now. And, you know, it's the joke you kind of expect, where, like, the kid kicks the adult's ass. And to me, that's a little, like, played out, right? It's like, okay, yeah, I get it. But then Jack Black, like, tackles this fucking guy off, like, the second story and, like, lands on him and, like, crushes
him. Probably should have killed him.
And I was like, okay, that was fucking bold. Like, that's pretty fucking funny to me, the way he just, like, slams this little fucker down. It's like, goddamn, you little piece of shit.
Yeah.
I love that.
Is that...
But, I mean, other than that... Just the presence of the kid doesn't do much
for
me.
That kid was based on an actual kid, though, I thought.
Two brothers.
Yeah. They were like 10 years old, and they were like leader of these, like, they were like leaders of this guerrilla camp.
I honestly feel like one of my few complaints about this movie is they shouldn't have taken back the violent child deaths. Like when that other little dude half squat gets thrown off the bridge. Yeah, that was awesome. It undercut it a little bit that they showed him like dusting off himself off, I thought. That felt a little safe.
I felt the exact same way. Funny, though.
What's so funny about it, Brett?
I think him pouting is funny to me, though, but yeah.
I love how he's just like stabbing Ben Stiller in like the jugular when he's like riding his back. And I was wrong as he's going across.
I'm watching this scene right now. Jack Black screaming my ass is so funny in this scene. I'm sorry, but it shows who plays the straight man in this movie.
Jay Baruchel
shows him.
I love
like,
Jay Baruchel.
He's in pain. Kirk Lazarus is Kirk Lazarus again. He's holding him, and it pans to Jack Black. Just sitting like a child screaming my ass. It's so brilliant.
Is there any truth to the Jay Baruchel, Kevin Sandusky? By the way, I get so many great names in this movie, but is there any truth to the whole Blu-ray versus HD DVD thing?
Yes.
That he's
that sounds right.
Oh,
yes.
Yeah, that's
yes.
Yeah, that's real.
Because yes. Of porn and PlayStation.
Literally the VHS system was 90% porn in the 80s, and like it was saved by what's her name? Jane Fonda and her workout videos. But yeah, like it was 90% were porn. So I have a feeling that's true.
At that time it was PS3 and 360, and 360, you had to buy like an add-on to plug it into your 360, which is like an HD DVD drive. Tough. And PS3 already had the Blu-ray in it. So,
are you talking to me? Talking to whoever's listening, man.
Yeah.
hitting another sour beer note. I think Jay is he just does okay.
He's a straight man.
Everyone really knocks it out of the park, but he doesn't stay super straight. He gets a little like goofy, you know? I don't know. Something about it. I don't think he knocked it out of the park. That's all I'm saying. He wasn't bad, but
I like him in everything, but I like him.
I don't know a lot about him. Like, what else is he in, Britt? But he feels like he should be Justin Long in this movie. Like, this feels like there should be a role for. Yeah.
Well, he's in Million Dollar Babies and This is the End. He's the main character in This is the End.
He's in Goon.
He's in.
He plays the same character in This is the End.
He's gonna rear their child.
The straight. He's a straight guy.
And he writes a lot. Yeah.
Yeah, he's a writer.
Fanboys, which will be a spoilers pick one day.
Fanboys is good.
We should do Goon. Like someone said Goon. That's a good movie.
Yeah, it is.
Goon's good, yeah.
Another thing that happens at the heroin camp is the Simple Jack performance, which is it's just great. Like
Simple Jack is a classic Stevie spoiler reference. You've just yelled that Simple Jack at random times before,
dude.
I didn't know what it was.
Funny.
What were you gonna say, Pat?
Sorry, Pat.
My brain's not good.
Also, I love how Maria Menounos like busts him out in the Access Hollywood thing.
She beat cancer, by the way, Stevie.
Awesome. Let's go, that's awesome to hear.
She was just diagnosed in January, and by May, she had beaten it.
Good, good.
Because they got it early enough, I believe. That's what I read.
Absolutely love to hear it. But just on the Simple Jack thing, sorry, I think, Brett, a long time ago, you're going to say there's like five things or something that people get offended at. And that's
there's at least three. I saw three people. Picketed. Yeah, go ahead.
The Simple Jack thing like caused up more of a shitstorm at the time even than Robert Downey Jr. doing Blackface.
Well, they made well, I actually think it's funny, and I think I would have thought it was funny, but they probably made a mistake. They actually made a Simple Jack website like about the movie. So in hindsight, they actually took that down, but they didn't change anything else. And it's just it's satire. They're saying how far people will go, and it fits in so perfectly with RDJ's speech. I don't know. But yes, that was the big one. That's what actually got picketed at the premiere.
But Simple Jack thought he was smart, or rather didn't think he was retarded, so he can't afford to play retarded being a smart actor. Playing a guy who ain't smart but thinks he is, that's tricky.
Hmm. tricky.
Is that working with mercury? It's high science, man. It's art form.
Yeah.
You an artist.
That's what we do, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hats off for going there. Especially knowing how the academy is about that shit.
Wait. About what?
You serious? You don't know. Everybody knows you never go full retard.
Who's the worst example of, like, a real life actor playing, like who's...
Rosie O'Donnell.
Yeah.
You think that Simple Jack?
I can't think of a worse one.
Sean Penn, I Am Sam.
Yeah, but that's like a good much movie, better actor.
Sean Penn turned down the role of Kirk Lazarus, I heard, in a...
Probably because of Simple Jack.
That would have been
insane. That would have been too much.
Probably because of Simple Jack. That would have been... Sean Penn telling Ben Stiller you never go full R-word would have just been so perfectly ironic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
You guys can edit me if you want, but there was a skit on Weekend Update 20 years ago that I thought was really funny. And like, if you look for it, it's really hard to find. It was Tina Fey, and it was I Am Sam 2, Still Tarded.
Oh, God.
Well, after a heartbreaking loss last year, Mick, a blue terrier, won Best in Show this week at the Westminster Dog Show. The only way this year's contest could have gone any better for Mick would be if he had any idea of what the hell was going on.
Actor Colin Farrell this week brought his mother to the premiere of his new movie Daredevil, sparking rumors that they are dating. Friends of Mini-Me actor Vern Troyer are concerned for his health, saying he's started drinking again. Apparently, things have gotten so bad that Troyer is up to 4 thimbles of scotch a day. And that's on a weeknight. Vern's friends are desperately trying to get him to go to a lowercase AA meeting.
It was announced this week that video game company Atari is going out of business. When asked to comment, the company said...
Sean Penn is claiming that he lost out on a promised role in a movie because of his trip to Iraq and his opposition to the U.S.-led war, thus depriving the world of I Am Sam 2, Still Tarded.
February is known the world...
Again, I get why it was taken down. I mean, it's Weekend Update. That's what they do. But like, it's kind of, it's a lot harder to find than it should be.
I Am Sam 2.
Yeah.
Sometimes they go fucking wild with that Weekend Update shit.
You can edit me out, but don't let them make sure they know that I didn't say the R word.
Is Simple Jack probably closer to Gilbert Grape?
Dude, it's hard. He's so good at that, though. So freaking good at that.
Yeah.
It's kind of hard to say because, like, the movie has to suck for it to be comparable to the Simple Jack, right? It has to be, like, an awful take. And, you know,
I mean,
What's Eating Gilbert Grape's pretty good. You know, I Am Sam's pretty good. The Juliette Lewis one's pretty good.
What about when Harrison Ford gets shot in the head?
Yeah, I was going to say that earlier. I didn't know if anyone remembered that.
Regarding Henry?
Regarding Henry.
Yeah. It's a terrible fucking movie.
Steve, you follow the movie industry pretty closely. You read the trades everything. Do you think that's good advice? Never go full R-word? Would you give that advice to one of your clients?
I mean, we just witnessed it with that movie that that Sia made.
Tall Girl one or whatever?
No, what's it called?
It's Sia. It's one word, right?
Music like or lyric or... What is that movie called? But
I'll get it.
I just watched it and I literally went, well, they obviously haven't seen Simple Jack. Like, like no one...
It was like Oscar bait.
Yeah, it was pure...
And you learned nothing.
Like Oscar bait, and you're like, all right, like...
Yeah, it's called Music.
Music, yeah, and it's just... I mean, it takes it a step far. It's one of those cringe things you watch, you're like, Jesus Christ.
What's it about? I mean, music, but...
She's autistic.
Like... not even like high functioning, but like super like autistic.
She likes music.
Yeah. And she wears headphones. That's what like keeps her clear. And we get to see like
people were really mad about the seizure scene that they didn't like.
And we get to see like the inside of her brain when she has like music going. It's yeah.
Ooh, isn't Baby Driver? Baby Driver, isn't he a little bit like on the spectrum?
No, he has tinnitus. It's like he has Bell's palsy. He just has tinnitus.
I feel like movies have a harder time today doing anything like that, and maybe even Tropic Thunder would have a harder time today because things get like clipped and shared. You know what I mean? Like a 10-second clip of like Ben Stiller and Robert Downey Jr. saying the R word, like on TikTok, people would like lose their fucking minds. I feel like because there's no context then.
But do you guys remember last year when Robert Downey Jr. was trending because of Tropic Thunder?
No.
And Ben Stiller came out and literally said, "I don't give a crap. I wouldn't change anything." So
yeah, good for him. Because like people were mad that people found out that Robert Downey Jr. quote unquote did blackface.
Where have they been?
They weren't born yet. They just need something to be offended by.
Yeah. And like I said, he got an Oscar nomination. The Academy, not known for being a very staunch body of people. I feel like
that's just how freaking good he was.
Yeah. I don't know. We've been all over the place, but any other like particular scenes that you guys like? Anything you want to talk about in terms of the plot?
The Chinese scene to me, it was amazing. I don't know. I think his acting there is so good and so funny. Sorry.
I feel like
we don't have to talk about it.
Robert Downey Jr. does a lot of acting with his eyes in this movie.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Oh my God. Especially the Chinese part I'm talking about. Yeah.
And it's really fun to watch. Just the other thing I want to say was you guys don't, what dancing don't you like from Les Grossman, Tom Cruise?
I love it all.
It reminds me at the end of Dodgeball. Is that where Ben Stiller's like dancing in the fat suit?
Okay, so you're talking about the end credits or like in the movie?
In the movie, it's fine. I'm talking about the very, very end.
Dude, in the movie, it's brilliant. When he turns the music back on and he's like backpedaling away to Apple Bottom Jeans away from Matthew McConaughey, that's gold.
I'm with you. Sorry for conflating that.
You just didn't like the ludicrous at the end?
Correct. I don't like
the credits.
That's something like that's a Ben Stiller thing, like a goofy dance to end the movie in a fun way. And I think it's stupid. I hate that.
It's too much.
Thanks, Corey. Mm-hmm. It's really lame.
Wait, so we're 3-2 right here. What about you, Mikey?
I think I liked it at the time. I think there's so many other much funnier parts, just even lines like when Tug Speedman is again with the head, and then the Chinese or the Asian guy is up in the forest and like they have no fear of death. I thought that was hilarious.
I'm not saying it's anywhere near the funniest part. I just don't think it's terrible.
Yeah, I guess it's not the worst.
It's silly,
but it's
though, I guess.
Yeah, it's way sillier, I guess, than the rest of the movie. But the whole movie's silly.
They have no fear of death. Ben Stiller's really good in that scene.
Tom Cruise just kills it, though, as Les Grossman, despite that. Like, even when I first saw this in theaters, which is kind of a cool experience, which I'll talk about in a sec, but like that was my main takeaway from this movie. I remember coming out of this and being like, it had some funny parts. It was okay. But like that Tom Cruise shit, like fucking killed me. Every time he's yelling, that really gets me. But speaking of it, seeing it in theaters, you know, this movie opens with fake trailers and it blends so well into a theater experience, right? Because it starts off with fucking Scorcher, Tug Speedman's like dumb post-apocalyptic action movie, right? The Escape from LA vibes are coming through it.
Oh yeah.
But
who left the
film? Yeah.
Dude, the Tobey Maguire joke is so subtle and so brilliant. Like 5-time Academy Award winner Lazarus Osiris and MTV's Best Kiss Award winner, Tobey Maguire. That's really funny.
And they're using
the fucking true
real actor's name mixed in there with the Tug Speedmans of the world.
Well, even the credits, because it says Red Hour Ben right before the movie actually like kicks off, or Red Hour Productions, and that's Ben Stiller's production. So it's like his production title card or whatever is like mixed in with these fake trailers right before the movie starts. It's really cool.
What a great parody on Brokeback too.
Yeah. Oh, it looks like a funny movie. I wouldn't say funny, but when he reaches down with like his pinky and he grabs the beads.
Yeah, it's amazing.
It's so funny. It shouldn't be funny, but it's funny to me.
To be condemned is to die.
In a time where to be different was to be condemned. And to be condemned was to die. One man chose to question his God. From Fox Searchlight. Five-time Academy Award winner Kirk Lazarus. And MTV Movie Award Best Kiss winner Tobey Maguire. Winner of the Beijing Film Festival's coveted Crying Monkey Award, Satan's Alley.
I've been a bad, bad boy, Father.
And I feel like I have seen like that movie, you know, a couple times. So like it kind of makes it like those movies are still being made, like that Forbidden Love, like drama, right?
You've seen that, Corey. So what do they end up doing with the beads? If you've seen it, can you fill us in? Ooh. What happens?
I think you know,
Josh. We all know what they do with the beads. Come on,
they make bracelets.
Any other scenes that stood out to you guys? Anything else you guys want to talk about from Tropic Thunder? I don't think we get... Steve, did we do enough justice to Nick Nolte? He read the book, a spoilers meme at this point. He's amazing in this.
There's some great jokes, too. Like, you know, Beds Give Me Nightmares, wrote the book. I don't know the name of it, just the sound it makes when it takes another man's life. You know, and you're getting into this, like, crazy person, and then it comes to find out that he has hands. And
you grew hands?
Danny McBride is so betrayed by it.
Three different people say they react. Like, Robert Downey Jr. says, I'm like, oh, did you grow hands?
Did you grow hands? I just, like, and Danny McBride has some great lines with him, too. Like, you know, I serve my country. I'm a patriot. And Danny McBride's like, you are the Milli Vanilli of patriotism.
Yeah. And just the fact that it's like Nick Nolte's idea to make him go in the woods and he's never left the States.
Never left the States.
slapping him, Al Pacino, when he slaps him and says, for 400 years, that word has kept us down. That is such a freaking funny little thing. And the part that made me laugh earlier, that it's so stupid, but when he comes and goes, peekaboo, I see you. That's freaking funny. Robert Downey Jr. saying that. Just is like, I never would have thought that. It's really funny to me. He's so good. Mm.
Can I ask my other Stevie question as a final thought?
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
Because I know you've thought a lot about this. This movie posits that within Simple Jack, the movie, there is a good movie in there. Can you spell
it just
out?
Did better hands?
Tell us about the hands, Rider Stevie. Strike. The hands.
I mean,
they hear the Ben Stiller octopus blown up hands at the beginning of the movie. There's no hands.
It does posit that there's a good movie in there somewhere. Part of me almost wishes that instead of like showing Scorcher, I mean, instead of showing Scorcher 6. Like, maybe just throw in Simple Jack at the end. Maybe. But almost make it look like an action movie. I think that would have been hysterically funny. But I think Simple Jack is one of those movies where there's no coming back from it. Like, there is no acting your way out of Simple Jack.
I thought maybe you'd say...
It's just a bad movie no matter what.
There's, like, some deep art there. And, like, he maybe wouldn't...
According to Kirk Lazarus, there is. When he was given notes... during his play, He thinks that he's actually doing a decent job. Maybe there is a good movie in there.
Like, maybe he could have been misunderstood in his own time, sort of thing.
Dude, Ben Stiller's face when the one guy from the heroin production company says, "You should have won the Oscar." Like, it's like you can just see like the light in his eyes. He's so happy because of that.
You should have won Oscar.
Yeah. Only other final thoughts that I had, the first cut of this movie was 3.5 hours long.
Oh, mama.
That seems like a bit much. Like, that seems crazy.
I want to see
it. Has anyone seen the director's cut?
No.
No.
It's like a little over 2 hours long. It's actually on Amazon.
And last final thought I had, this dethroned The Dark Knight at the box office, ending its run. 2008, pretty good year for movies, actually. Yeah, fun summer.
Dark Knight, Milk.
Was Jimmy Cox that year?
That was later, wasn't it? Walk Hard.
We'll check on that. But are you guys ready for yes or no?
No, it was a year. That was a year before, damn. Stevie, 2007.
And the only thing I'll add, Pap, though, is the original script of this movie sounds hysterically funny, but I'm happy with the cut we got. Justin Theroux's original script was, you know, four big action stars going to boot camp for a Vietnam movie they're going to shoot, and then coming back and going to therapy for the PTSD they have from boot camp. Funny. Like, that to me still sounds really funny, but I actually prefer this version a lot.
It sounds like a whole different movie, obviously.
Yeah.
I feel like it's you're not supposed to. Or you're supposed to unironically like the soundtrack, but I love the score and I love the soundtrack. I love what it comes in on. You know, you could have done your classics, but I love that it comes in on Ball of Confusion by the Temptations when they're in the helicopter. I think that's perfect. Like, it would have been a little too on the nose.
CCR.
On the helicopter, they're coming in on Fortunate Son, you know?
Yeah, you do get run through the jungle at some point.
But that's... You're allowed to play CCR in a soundtrack, guys. They're pretty freaking awesome.
Well, it's law. You have to play CCR in every Vietnam movie, though. That's law.
On the topic of music, I like the ancient lamentation music that plays at both like the beginning and the end as, what's his name? Tug Speedman has his like dramatic fall when he's being shot at by the enemy.
Has his Willem Dafoe fall?
The platoon.
Yeah.
I like the sexy soundtrack during the Kirk Lazarus trailer. Toby. Very porno-esque.
And Apple Bottom Jeans Low is so of its time for this movie. Because that song was huge at this time.
Well, I read that they actually put that in like afterwards because it had become a hit like after they had shot it. So, but yeah, I guess that's not that crazy.
The script is freaking amazing. Like, it's so funny, and like even the way that like it falls back on itself, like the fake movie that they're doing, and like how it Owen Wilson, or not Owen Wilson, Matthew McConaughey throws the TiVo to block the RPG. TiVo also very of its time.
Shit,
if you guys have any final thoughts, let's get into yes or no. I'll go first. First of all, Sebastian, thank you so much for being a Patreon. I great pick. Honestly, probably a classic comedy. Probably one of the best comedies from its decade. I think anyone with a modicum of like context or understanding like what the movie's trying to do or poke fun at won't have any problem with the contents of the movie. And RDJ, I don't know how many times he's been nominated for an Oscar, but...
Twice?
Yeah. Totally deserving in this role. And that's like a big deal, to get nominated in a comedy movie as a supporting character for your performance. Well-deserved. Hilarious movie. Great pick again, Sebastian. Thank you. We'll go east to west on this. I think Brett...
Okay. So yeah, this was, am I the only one here that this was my first time watching it, or?
Oh, you'd never seen it before?
Nope, I hadn't, no.
That's crazy.
Yeah. I'd seen parts of it, but no, oh my God, I was laughing like hysterically the whole movie. I thought it was really, really funny. I love the cast. You probably wouldn't be able to afford the cast now because, RDJ is really expensive, and so is,
Jack Black.
Yeah, Jack Black, but yeah. And Matthew McConaughey. But
yeah,
no, this movie's amazing. I think it was freaking hilarious.
Tom Cruise.
Like,
Bill Hader.
For sure.
Jeez.
But it's like kind of a little bit of dark comedy, but I love the satirization of Hollywood. It's just so funny. It's not like too on the nose. It's really awesome. It is obvious, but it's got a lot of subtle tones to it too. I loved everything about it. It was really, really funny. Hard, hard, hard yes for me.
Is it?
Was?
I think it is, Josh.
I was just looking for some leadership, Pep. I got it.
Hey, like Stevie says, you're grown adults. I don't have to hold your hand. You know the order by now.
Josh from Goshen. This movie, something we haven't talked about is that there's some early scenes where they're shooting the movie within the movie. And they're like on a helicopter, and there's like kind of a platoon type scene where Ben Stiller's character is getting shot up, and Jay's character looks out and points that, oh, I think he's still alive. And there's like a little bit of a movie within a movie that they shoot. And towards the end of the actual movie, Tropic Thunder, the real events in the jungle start to mirror that more and more directly. And just the way that kind of culminates, I think, is like just really genius movie making, that it just like feels right or something when you're watching it. I like to think that there's an alternate reality where the director did fake his death and it wasn't a real landmine he stepped on or something like that. But I love this movie. Thanks, y'all, for talking about it. Thanks to the listeners for listening. Huge, huge, throbbing Vigo, yes.
Oh yeah, this is the hardest of yeses. I absolutely love this movie. Like Pap, you said earlier, I love movies about making movies, and this really veers off from that and becomes its own thing. And the fact that it's not a spoof, I think, makes it all that much better. I love the cast, and Ben Stiller is a really good writer, and he's a really good director. For anybody who hasn't seen Severance, Ben Stiller directed 6 of the 9 episodes. And it's like masterclass of directing. I advise anybody who likes mind-bending sci-fi to go watch that show in a heartbeat. It's on Apple. But yeah, I absolutely love this movie. And I wish you brought it up at some point, but I didn't. When they're making the movie in the beginning, like the movie within the movie at the beginning, it's just little stuff, but the line where Lincoln Osiris looks back at the helicopter when he's going to save Four Leaf, and he's like, "Cover me, you limp dick fuck-ups!" It's just... I like that line a lot. And I think this movie is just really funny, and contextually, it's just a really good satire on a way to look at Hollywood and how serious some people take themselves. So, thank you, Sebastian. Hardest of yeses.
Ben Stiller really slowed down from acting. Didn't he? I'm looking at his IMDb. One of his last credits is Hubie Halloween. One of the last movies he was in. Mikey.
Yeah, it's a super hard yes. Super hard Vigo yes. I'm looking at Ben's directing IMDb credits, and you know, he's got a lot of TV stuff that I haven't seen, but the movies, other than Zoolander 2, it's like, I like all of this stuff. Zoolander, Tropic Thunder, Secret Life of Walter Mitty is like honestly one of my favorite movies. I don't even know why. I think it's just a really great looking movie, and I like the journey he goes through the entire way. It's one of my faves, and yeah, I do want to see Severance. That looks very interesting as well, but I think he's a great director, and he plays the beautiful idiot so well and like everything that he's in, and it's just like so convincing, and he's just really great in everything that he's in. The cast is stacked, great music, great setting, like shooting all this stuff in a real jungle, it looks insane how good it looks. Just a real funny movie. Really pushes the boundaries of of comedy, and yeah, it might seem problematic, but it's such a satire on Hollywood, which I appreciate because Stevie likes movies made talking about Hollywood. I don't really care for that, but I really like this movie because it just puts so much emphasis on how ridiculous Hollywood is. So it's a lot of fun to watch. And RDJ is just like, this is like the funniest character of like, I couldn't name a funnier character in like the last 20 years. Like this has got to be top five for sure. Just so out there and such a big risk for him at the time. Just what a home run for him somehow. But yeah, it's a super hard yes.
And
thank you, Sebastian. Fun movie.
Yeah, clap it up for Sebastian one last time. But last and not least, host of Big Dumb Movie, Corey Kylo Ren Memes. Will you make this movie preserved?
Thank you, Pappy. You're a great American. This podcast owes you a huge debt.
Now shut the fuck up and let me do my job.
Hello. I'm going to give this one a soft yes. I will keep it preserved, Pappy.
A comedy yes.
A comedy yes. A movie I don't love, but a movie I like. I watched it for this podcast, and just like when I saw it in the theater, I laughed a couple times, and I was amused several times by like some of the concepts within the movie. I'm not totally into comedies, as you guys know, so it's not always super easy for me to give them a yes. I was leaning toward no, but you guys talking about some of the stuff did remind me of like the comedic value of some of the moments that I didn't even love myself particularly. It's pretty good. Ben Stiller is fucking jacked. And I can't get over that when I'm watching this movie. Like, I'm constantly thinking about how fucking buff he is. It's amazing. He's like Tony Perkis times two, you know? Mm-hmm. He really went all
out. Still got that Fokker muscle.
I really like the Simple Jack stuff. Again, more in concept. Just thinking about an actor doing that just rings so true to me. Just like this, like, huge action actor that is like kind of an airhead and is known for just like repeating the same bullshit. It would be like Vin Diesel, like nowadays, right? If he tried to do some like movie like that, like Vin Diesel would do some Simple Jack shit, right? Everyone knows him for Fast and the Furious is completely like mindless bullshit. That's what he would do. It would be so funny. But to just cap it off, Brett brought up something that we can't let slide. It's like so apt and on point what Brett just said. Brett is right. This movie can't be made today. And the reason is it would be too fucking expensive.
Yeah.
That's the reason this movie can't be made today.
You're 100% right.
That's all I got.
Super A-listers. Yeah.
Just even like shooting on location like that, they wouldn't put that money into a comedy. It's a straight to Netflix deal.
Stevie. Timothy Chalamet in blackface. We can make it happen. We can write this movie.
Dude, he'd take it. I think we can end his career pretty quick.
Yeah, I would say you would lead the charge to cancel him.
I mean, I wouldn't be against it. Like, I don't love cancel culture, but I wouldn't, you know, would not try to point it out that maybe you shouldn't.
You're not excited for Wonka or what?
Bring up Timothy Chalamet. He's in a good mood. Don't get him in a bad mood.
No, I know. I saw that trailer and it put me in a good mood because I think he might be pulled back a little bit. We'll see.
He might be taken down a peg.
He's taken down a peg after this one. This one has like lost $100 million at the box office, you know, type stuff written all over it. So we'll see.
I really appreciated you and Pappy, Stevie, talking about Ben Stiller, like lingering on him a little bit. Like, this is really his movie. I think when people think about it, they think about Robert Downey Jr. maybe first. And man, what a career he's had. Even if he's slowed down with the acting a little bit, like all the sets he's been on, he's in like the Wes Anderson stuff. He does voice stuff. He's, you know, he's a constant with Adam Sandler. his dad being in, being a like real prevalent Hollywood actor, and I don't. He's even like
Costanza and son.
He's even on
his
like
parents are both really famous
friends and stuff. Like, I don't know. He has a pretty crazy career if you really think about it.
Oh, so what would you guys think of? I don't know if this is true or not, but I read that Ben Stiller originally wanted to play the agent role and Speed Tugman or Tug Speedman was going to be Keanu Reeves.
I mean, do you think, Stevie, that the Keanu Reeves was as loved in 2008 as he is
people
now?
People forget like, this.
No, yeah.
Yeah, I know. We were talking about that on John, on and John
I feel like,
Wick.
I feel like he would see it as making fun of himself. You know, like
I think like he was making Street Kings at this point. If anybody remembers that movie,
let's see what he was making in 2007.
I mean, Constantine was before this. I think Constantine was 2006. I think Street Kings was maybe
2005.
Is that 2005?
Is Constantine, Scanner Darkly 2006, Lake House
2006. Don't sleep on Lake House.
Didn't make a movie in 2007. And then Street Kings in The Day the Earth Stood Still.
Hey, I was right. Street Kings. Yeah, but, yeah.
This gets ugly. It gets ugly after that.
Yeah, it's real ugly. And Keanu, I mean, I don't know if this movie would have had the same pull. Like, Ben Stiller was a way bigger name at this time than Keanu Reeves. Like, way bigger.
Jack Black was definitely bigger.
Like, Jack Black was way bigger. Like,
built first.
Yeah. It's, this would have been an entirely different movie. I don't think Keanu could have done what Ben Stiller did in this movie. As much as I love Keanu, I'm against him playing the lead role.
I'm thinking of Keanu now, which is amazing, and we would have had fun with it. But yet, Keanu in 2007, it's a different animal. So this is probably perfect.
I mean, yeah, to your
Plus,
point,
like,
though,
Ben Stiller getting intense. Go ahead. Sorry, I'm done.
And to your point, though, Josh, like, Ben Stiller writing, producing, and starring in this movie, like, pretty fucking incredible, actually.
And directing, yeah.
Yeah.
Is it even possible? It's like, we've talked about this before. It's like coaching a basketball team and playing in the game. It's kind of hard to imagine the feasibility of it.
While you're an athletic director and the bus driver.
I mean, a producer is a very loose term in Hollywood, though. That could just be money.
So yeah, especially executive producer, it's pretty much just money. But you also can do a little casting stuff, I think.
It could also be a very big job.
Before I get to trivia, we do have a couple comments that have come in. These are on Spotify. You can leave a comment on a specific episode. We got a good and I don't know what to make of it. The good friend of the podcast, David, just submitted today on the Sudden Death episode.
Yes.
Best movie podcast in the game, except no substitutes. Great VA work, BK. The screams were on point. Can you give us a scream, Brett, from Sudden
I don't
Death?
Even remember.
Yeah, you do. Come on.
Who screamed?
The guy falling off the roof. David's gonna take back his comment after that one, but we might get more
edit it out.
We might get more comments like Mr. Isili,
Mr. Icicle.
Brett, this is on your pick, The 13th Warrior, and your host. Bad episode for fans of the film. At one point, they're joking about not remembering the characters' names. Only two of the 13 warriors had.
That's just patently untrue, but he can have his opinion. I admit that we
Shut
got
up,
a little
bitch.
Off track.
Oh my god.
Scared me. For the hardcore Thertarians, I don't know, I was trying to make up a nickname, but it didn't really work. You know, we didn't have to talk about the plot much because there wasn't much of one, but I'm looking through all these names, and every single one of them's got a name, especially in the book, which I read. I mean, I wrote the book.
This guy needs to realize we can't even review Fellowship of the Ring without taking the piss out of it. the 13th warrior isn't going to escape like a little bit of cynicism from the boys here at spoilers.
I just don't think that he listened.
Yeah. First of all, it's considered a humongous bomb and it was almost preserved. Give us some credit.
Yeah, way too many yeses.
Fuck you, Mr. Icicle.
I'm not saying Frosty that. He might say that. I want you to keep listening. Hopefully we can win you over on a different pod. What else do you want? John Carter?
If he likes icicles, maybe he'd like our Mr. Freeze episode, right, Kylo? Ooh, and you can check out the other half of it on Patreon only.
Mr. Freeze, if you become a Patreon, I promise we'll make a priority of your episode. Yeah, Mr. Icicle. Yeah, but I do have trivia, like you mentioned. Oh, and one last thing I want to mention. Sebastian, not just a Patreon, boys, a rock hard Viggo Mortensen.
Whoa.
Patreon.
Wow.
So he'll get another pick. Great pick so far, Sebastian. You're one for one. But thanks, as Sebastian. A spoilers tradition, we have a trivia. It's the game we played a couple times. Farthest from, but just a series of closest twos. Whoever's the farthest from each round will be eliminated. I went off just the most recent host order. Which I have a Stevie, Brett, Corey, Josh, Mikey. First question. Farthest from is eliminated. The number of Seinfeld episodes Jerry Stiller appeared in. According to IMDb.
Ran for 9 seasons. All right, let me do this in my head real quick. So, 24 episodes a season.
This is to throw it to Spoiler Man, by the way, and have a hot take.
I'll say my man from Costanza and Son was in 157.
157. Brett?
I'm going to go 156. I think it was much less than that, but you... guys watch Seinfeld more than me. I might be screwing myself.
156. Corey.
155.
Yes, I'm definitely not eliminated.
Will you repeat the question, Pat?
Yeah. The number of Seinfeld episodes Jerry Stiller appeared in.
I'm just going to do a little bit of a low ball. I'll say 120.
120? And Mikey. One of the biggest Seinfeld heads on the pod, I would say.
Yeah, I don't remember him being on that many episodes. I'm going to say 100.
100. The actual retail number of episodes.
The answer will shock you.
27.
What? I thought it was way 64. More.
He's like Jaws.
Every yeah. He wasn't even up. Every
he wasn't even the original one. He wasn't even the original dad.
I knew he wasn't, but he's chewed up so much scenery in there. I thought he had a great.
You want a piece of me?
I thought he just had this giant impact.
There's right, no stop way.
Short. That's all right. I stop short.
Stop short. Second question. How many square miles of rainforest are in Vietnam?
Oh my god.
Oh jeez.
Brett.
Rough book. Oh my god. Square miles. 1800.
1800.
That's so wrong.
Corey.
1801.
Solid guess by Corey. Josh.
100,000.
100,000. Mikey.
I'll say 5,000.
5,000. The actual retail number of miles, square miles, in Vietnam of rainforest 8,700. Joshua, bye-bye. Way off.
Oh, Mikey, wait, yeah.
Incredible guess. Mikey, very close to the answer.
I spent some time in Vietnam a long time ago.
You ran a sweatshop. You lost a lot of good men in that sweatshop.
Man, I just didn't want to be boring and say 1802, but there you go. That's what happens, folks.
Mikey loves CCR, boys. You can't stop him. On that note, how many degrees Fahrenheit does napalm burn at? Or at how many degrees Fahrenheit does napalm burn? Brett?
As we all know, jet fuel doesn't burn.
Hey.
Easy, Brett.
It burns. It doesn't melt steel beams, is the saying.
It weakens them. Fuck's sake.
Yeah, dude, trust me. I know. Dumbest thing in the world that people think that, but anyway. Yeah.
Fahrenheit, napalm, breath.
God, I have no idea. I'm so bad at science.
Jet fuel detonates buildings from the bottom up. Oh.
Oh, God, Josh.
Josh.
Corey.
Under. I mean, come on.
2999?
22, yeah. 22999.
Mikey.
A thousand.
Actual number of retail degrees, 1,800.
Oh, that's close.
I think Corey.
Mikey said what?
1,000, so he was off by 800.
Yeah, so it's Mikey.
Oh, yeah, sorry, did Mikey. You're eliminated.
I said 2,300,
yep. Yeah. You're right. Mikey, I'm sorry. You've been eliminated.
And weirdly, someone guessed 1,800 square miles of rainforest in Vietnam.
Oh, wrong guess.
So we have the classic matchup, Corey v. Brett, to throw it to Spoiler Man. According to the Wikipedia entry, theatrical films about the Vietnam War, how many Vietnam War movies have there been?
1,800. 1,800.
This is one of those tables in Wikipedia, you know. This was theatrical films. Theatrical films about the Vietnam War. It doesn't say all time. That was the title of the table in Wikipedia.
Oh, man. So, probably didn't first, man. Deer Hunter, let's just say Deer Hunter was the first one. I'm sure it wasn't, but let's just say that. Say there was three a year since 1978. 22,
45, 90, 135. Viet fucking Nam!
Corey.
Under.
134. The actual number.
It's gotta be under.
Of retail theatrical films about the Vietnam War. 76, according to Wikipedia.
Wow.
Corey, you're a fortunate son. You are the champion.
They all have CCR.
Oh, for the red, white, blue.
It ain't me. Corey, go ahead. You have some time for a hot take. Kick it to Spoiler Man. Anything you want to say?
Well, I'm very excited for a patron pick coming up. And that is Blood In, Blood Out. Was that Jason that picked that?
Yeah.
Cheese Zombie. Yes.
Is that Cheese Zombie is? These fucking Patreon names, I never know who they are. And sometimes they're like people I interact with on my Big Dumb Movie account. I had David. I don't know. He said it was him and I was like talking about him. Anyway, I'm very excited for Blood In, Blood Out. If you guys haven't seen it, it's like a classic Southern California gangster movie from the early 90s. It's beautiful. It's so stupid sometimes that it's hilarious. Like, it's, I don't know if it's intentionally or unintentionally funny at times, and you guys will know what I mean when you see those moments. It's insane, but it is super long. It's like 3 hours long.
Wow.
It's like a prison epic. So, guys, be prepared for that one. Maybe that one might have to be split up into a couple. But anyway, it's been a lot of fun doing this podcast. That was my hot take or whatever. So I'll say, take it away, Spoiler Man. Fuck you.
Special thank you to our patrons, Matt Troll.
He may be able to see me, but I can't see him.
Brother Brian.
I see you. I see you. I see you.
Nick.
That's me, sir. It's good to finally meet you at last. Get some FaceTime.
The Meg.
This is your fault.
Nurse Stacy.
Shit the money bed, my friend.
The Wolf.
Barky 420.
You limey fuck!
Spencer.
You know how you handle an actor? They whine about anything. You pull down their pants and you spank their ass.
Swole.
Who is this guy?
Dr. Lars.
I wrote the book.
Druid King.
Oh. You're a great American. This nation owes you a huge debt.
Now shut the fuck up and let me do my job.
If you'd like to request an episode, hear your name read by Spoiler Man, or even just help us make podcasts, please check us out on patreon.com/spoilerspodcast. Our email is podcastspoilers@gmail.com.
Be sure to check out Corey's podcast, Big Dumb Movie.
Our Instagram is podcastspoilers. It's lit. Josh Hensley from the Rutabaga wrote our theme song. Please support this podcast by leaving us an iTunes review. Leave us some stars and some words. Now you can check us out on Spotify, YouTube, Stitcher, Apple, and Google Podcasts. Spoilers is now available on Audible.
Everybody knows you never go full retard.
What do you mean?
Check it out. Dustin Hoffman, Rayman, look retarded, act retarded, not retarded. Count two picks, cheat of cards, autistic, sure, not retarded. You got Tom Hanks, Forrest Gump. Slow, yes, retarded, maybe, braces on his legs, but he charmed the pants off next to him and won a ping pong competition. That ain't retarded. And he was a goddamn war hero. Right. You know any retarded war heroes? You went full retard, man. Never go full retard. You don't buy that? Ask Sean Penn, 2001, I am Sam. Remember? Went full retard. Went home empty-handed.
That was Spoilers.